everyone. It's so good to see you all. Thank you for joining us. I'm Amanda Forrester with the Roanoke Regional Small Business Development Center. And I'm just so excited to see all these faces. Thank you all. I've got my team here this morning, and so I'm just going to let them say hi. We've got Heather, who's our program director. I'm just going down here in the order that I see them on my screen. We've got Leo Pretty, who I'm going to introduce to you a little bit later. He's new to our team for the New River Valley. Hey, Leo.
Hey, good morning.
We've got Tom Tanner with us this morning, who's responsible for all of our advising and as well as the Roanoke region. And then we have Jeff Robertson on with us, who is responsible for our Franklin County region. Hey, Jeff.
Hey, everybody.
Okay, so let's get started. We have a lot to share today, a lot. We are recording this, so if you want to share it out with other people that might want to see what we're up to, we're going to upload it to our YouTube channel and you can find it there. And I will let you know via email that it's ready and out there later today. But let's roll right into it. I want to just start off with economic impact that we're seeing so far. And this information is year to date. And if you all may have been with us before, when we talk about this, we always hone in on this is information that our clients are giving to us. And so we do surveys twice a year to pick up maybe all the other clients who aren't actively giving us information. So these numbers do change very quickly, and it's not a full representation of what we're serving. We will have 2022 data available in early 2023. Usually it's the end of March when we have that data and all the surveys back in and collected. But I want to share with you what we have so far. We're really excited about these numbers, also a little stressed, quite honestly. We've served 1,130 small business owners this year to date. And to put that number in perspective, our grant funding and our match that we're responsible for gives us the capacity to serve 400 small business owners a year. So as you can see, we have over doubled that. We have put a lot of technology and processes in place to help us become more efficient and see more people. But we also, as you'll see later this morning, had a lot of additional funding over the past year, even 3 years, to allow us to do this type of work. So we do expect these numbers to fall next year when we no longer have our grant funds available to us. We've had 21 businesses start so far this year that have reported that they've started. We know that that number is much higher, but that is the official data that we have. We have helped retain and get 572 jobs across our region, and we've assisted with $7.3 million in capital for these businesses, which is typically lending. We've done about 25 loans this year. We want to do more of those. And so those are the numbers that we've seen year to date. And we can't wait to see when all of our surveys come back in what those numbers really are. I want to share with you too, as most of you know, we do a lot of events and programs and workshops. And this year alone, we've had 1,437 attendees at our events and workshops. So again, to put that in perspective, it's usually under 100. So we know that our small businesses love the virtual format. That's what allows us to get these attendee numbers, and they get to rewatch the videos once we post them on YouTube, which that's not even counted in these numbers for the additional people who see our work. These are actual seats that are on with us and attending our programs. We did 50 events out of our center this year. You all may also be aware we have 27 other centers in Virginia. And when they're doing something that's of interest to the small businesses in our region that we're not doing, we also support and promote those workshops. So a lot of attendees will attend things all across the state. And we're really happy to have a tight network that we can utilize and do that with so much expertise across the state. Another interesting number that I just love to capture and kind of track are our seat hours. And these are the hours that people sat in our programming and events across the year, and it's 13,000 hours that people were exposed to our work. And so we're always excited to watch that number. That's really where we find our impact. Those are the hours that people have spent with us learning new things about how to run their businesses. And so it's an important number for us to watch. I want to roll into one of the things that I want to talk about today, which is our Vet Biz program. You've heard me talk about it before. If you joined us this time last year, you heard me talk about it. But it's a program that Tom Tanner runs for us and coordinates our veteran-owned businesses in the region. And he does that through newsletters to get them information that they need that's specific to veteran-owned businesses, but also just general business information. And one of the really cool things we're excited about to launch now in November is our database. We have a database on our vetbizvirginia.org website where veteran-owned businesses can register their business based on their industry. And it helps them, one, network with other veteran business owners, but this is also open to the public if someone wants to search for a veteran business owner in an industry that you're interested in. This is great for contracting opportunities or other networking opportunities as it has to do with business. So we're excited to get this launched. We're in the process of having the veteran business owners that are part of our VetBiz program register, but it is live and available for use right now on vetbizvirginia.org. So we'd love for you to check that out. We're also seeking a sponsor for our VetBiz program, just our general overall sponsor that'll put you in front of all of our veteran-owned businesses, as well as the community at large, to show that you're supporting those businesses. And that sponsorship will help us not only maintain the database, but host our events that we started to have. We kicked off with our very first networking event that Tom held at the beginning of November with, I think, over 40 people in attendance, right, Tom? It was a great event. We had it at the VR Center in Salem. We hope to rotate businesses. And it was just a great time for them to connect and meet each other. Their families came, and it was a really fun time. We want to do that quarterly for them to help with those networking opportunities and cross-business opportunities that we know are there in the veteran community. So if you have interest in helping us sponsor this, please let me know. We'd love to get you on our website and into our branding and marketing that we do to our veteran-owned businesses. And you can reach out to me, and I'll provide my contact information at the end if you don't already have it. And then every year we do a Small Business Veteran of the Year Award, and we do present this with our host, the Roanoke Regional Chamber of Commerce. And this year's winner was Chris Desimone, which many of you might know from Star Tank. A few years ago, we started in this region a pitch contest, and while we haven't done that during COVID, we do hope to pick that back up on a greater regional level. But he was our winner this year, and he was second runner-up for our whole Virginia State Award. So we're really proud of Chris and the work that he does with veterans in our area. And of course, his business itself continues to grow. And so just really happy to see him get this award this year. You can check out all the other past year awards on the vetbizvirginia.org website. They're down at the bottom, and you can see, I don't know, how long have we been doing this, Tom?
2007, something like that.
Yeah. So it's a longstanding program and people really look forward to it every year. Okay, let's run into some small business economics. Okay, so what we're seeing around small business in our economy, and this is nationwide, but one of the things that we look at is how does this nationwide information, is it relevant to what we're seeing regionally with these businesses that we're serving? And in all of these cases, it's very applicable. So I want to share a couple of graphs from Dun and Bradstreet. If you're not familiar with them, they track the health of small business, and they have a small business health index, which is down. And this is as of September. Their October date will be coming. October data will be coming out anytime now. We're waiting on it. And I do have some November data for you here in just a little bit. But they track the health via how payments are made on credit card use. And it's a good way to kind of see what's financially happening in a business. And so as you can see here, payment delinquencies are up. business owners are using credit cards more, but they're also paying them on time more. So it's kind of mixed reviews. So the overall index is just down, not even a point. It's 0.3 points for September. As you can see in that spike, it is up from 2021. So we're still really happy about that and seeing that that stress, although we know it's on our businesses, it's becoming less of a burden. Here in a moment, though, I will be talking about their number one concerns, and part of that is their budget. So we'll look at that here in just a minute. I want to show you kind of the jobs health, and this is on the small business side. But if you look at the data for overall business or corporations, it's almost the same. I mean, we're seeing the same trends happen. And so this shows it as the health related to those businesses. It's only tracking the industries that you see here. And the 212,000 is the number of jobs that are expected to be added to small businesses in October of 2022. So that's what that number represents. Some of our industries that were hit really hard by the pandemic, healthcare, food services, are bouncing back, but those are also the ones that are more sensitive to rising interest rates and other financial services and real estate that's declining. Interest rates are going up, and that's becoming harder for those industries. Next up, I want to show you just the overall business health index, and it's down slightly, almost 2% points. And this is really just a weighted average of a viability rating, a delinquency predictor score, again, on those credit cards and payments, and then kind of total loss predictor. And that's kind of what gives us overall health. We always look at the financial stress that our small businesses are under, and this is a great way to measure that. And so you can see that as a benchmark, it is down in September. And then if you're familiar with the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, they do a small business index score, and they keep up with this quarterly. And you can read more about this on their website, the uschamberofcommerce.org. And they give Q3 of 2022 a 62.1. And that is the largest drop that we've seen since the pandemic. And so while it is higher than 2020 and early 2021, between quarters, it's the biggest drop that we've seen. And so we're certainly concerned about that, and our small businesses are concerned. Our regional score here in this region, which goes all the way down to Florida and across through Texas, it's a really big region, is 62.3. So it's right in line with the national average of what they're seeing. And again, if you want to see more of this data, you know, visit the U.S. Chamber of Commerce site. They do this report, and you can see all past data as well. I want to show you, though, when we talk about the biggest dip since COVID, I found this graph to be really helpful. This is from their website and the data that they track and kind of put together for us. And you can see at the start of the pandemic, shortly thereafter in Q2, once the shutdowns began, and then you can see it's starting to rise. It dips with some variants coming. And then we're still about 10 points under where we were at the start of the pandemic. But right here is what everyone is concerned about. The 66.8 down to 62.1. It's the biggest drop that we've seen in quite a while. And so let's talk about why we think that is based on surveying. Again, at the national level. And you can see these numbers here, and these are just a percentage of businesses that responded based on, you know, things that they're concerned about. But when we look at what are the top five concerns, number one is inflation. Number two is still supply chain. Although the good news about supply chain is that in the last 2 months, we've seen the lowest prices for what manufacturers are buying. So that's great news. We hope that that is a start of helping that supply chain challenge go lower on the list. Number three is revenue for small businesses, which also goes into how are they going to get the revenue? Can they pay back their loans? Is their lending accessible to them? So revenue covers a lot of concerns for small businesses. Number four is rising interest rates. You know, when they need to get a hold of money or they need to purchase real estate, they're certainly concerned about those interest rates and that's stopping them from growing their businesses. And then number five is still the pandemic. Number five is always like the lowest of their concerns. We rate the top five, but it's interesting to see that that's still on people's mind and trying to recover from that. Here in our region that we serve, we don't hear a lot about the pandemic anymore. People aren't coming to us about that as much or nearly as much as they were. We're mostly working with people who want to grow. They want to understand what's happening in their business, what's happening in the economy, and how they can adapt to it. So I do know that it's still on people's mind, but we're not consulting on that as much as we were in prior months. Okay, let's roll right into some shenanigans that we are up to, as I know you always enjoy watching everything that we've been doing. And so since we didn't have a Q3 update formally, this kind of covers everything since July. So I've got a couple of photos in here and videos that I want to share with you as we just walk through some of the things that we've been doing with the small businesses in our region. And we're going to start with foodiepreneur.
I'm a foodiepreneur.
I'm a foodiepreneur.
I'm a foodiepreneur.
I'm a foodiepreneur.
I am a foodiepreneur.
I'm a foodiepreneur.
I'm a foodiepreneur.
I'm a foodiepreneur.
Are you an aspiring, current, or veteran business owner in the food and drink industry? Then join us for our first annual Foodiepreneur Symposium on Monday, July 25th at the Vinton War Memorial. Come on out for a day of workshops, vendor networking, food, and hearing from industry experts to learn the things needed to scale and expand your food-based business in our region. Hosted by the Roanoke Regional Small Business Development Center, the Foodiepreneur event is a one-of-a-kind day built to inspire you to take it to the next level. But seats are filling up, so be sure to register today on our website at roanokesmallbusiness.org/food.
This was our
this symposium.
This symposium is for you.
It's for you.
It's for you.
This symposium is for you.
Oh, I just love these people to death. That was our foodie event that we did in July. It was a huge success. It sold out. We were able to give low price tickets and the event sold out. If you were able to be there, I think, Jill, are you on the line? I know you were able to come and visit for a bit. Roanoke County was one of our sponsors, and we just had a blast. It was an event like no other. It's hard to even describe unless you were there. I mean, we had entertainment, we had games, we had tons of experts, and instead of people talking to the group, we brought in business owners here who have been successful, some that you saw in that video, to talk with and engage with the audience. And so it was a really cool way to bring people together and not lecture them, but bring them into the conversation and really help them elevate their business and understand what others have done in our region to really grow their food-based businesses. So we had a great time doing that event and just really excited about the continued excitement from our food businesses around the event and having those resources available to them. Next up, we had our Minority Enterprise Celebration. We do this every year towards the end of the year. And this year we focused on COVID era lessons learned and had some great speakers from our region join us to talk about lessons that they learned in their business and then opened it up for a community conversation. If you haven't joined us for one of these events, you've got to join us. They are so empowering and we love listening to these entrepreneurs. We get down in the dirty and what they're really struggling with. This is not pretty stuff. It's the dirt, right? It's like, what are they struggling with and how do they pull out of it? And so I encourage you to watch for those as we do them in the coming year. They're always a lot of fun. Next up, I'm going to take you through a few pictures of a really big event that we did called Entrepreneur Her that launched this year. And this is a program for women business owners that culminates in some workshops throughout the year. Member One helped us kick it off in the spring. And then we rolled into the actual retreat where Freedom First was our main sponsor. And I just want to show you some videos from that day. It was a full day retreat. And when we say retreat, we mean retreat. Again, not lectures, but engaging content and really working through the day and how people can grow their businesses. So let's just, I'm going to flip through some of these photos so you can see some of the things in action. We had some amazing speakers that engaged with the crowd. Lots of time to work on their business and deep thought. Lots of fun from our panelists. And of course, drinks at the end of the day. And they ended there with a shot by the pool. We had a pool party to end the day. And then I can't wait to show you this. Heather, our program director who helped coordinate all this, after everyone had left, this is what we did. We got in the pool with our clothes on and celebrated. This was really 2 years in the making. So it was a big deal for us to finish. And next year, we look forward to doing this as an overnight retreat. So look for details on that. Again, this is another event that we sold out 2 weeks before it happened. Some people were really angry with us that we sold it out, but it notes that if you want to come to one of our big events, you got to get in early. We do have a budget that we have to hold to. So there's only a certain number of seats available. But we had about 60 people at this retreat. So really excited about those women entrepreneurs. And we continue to communicate with them. We actually have a WhatsApp channel that they can all connect and engage with each other. And it's just really fun to watch how they're connecting and growing their businesses together. So that continues on. Next up, again, I told you all it's been a busy year. We went out to California to our annual America's SBDC conference. So here's a picture of not quite all of us, but some of us and some people from our state office that we're good friends with and joined in. And then when we got back, we were really sad to have to let our CARES Act grant folks go. Our CARES Act grant did end in September. So some of our team members, we had Nicole here, and we had Macklin and Kat. Their end of term was at the end of September. So we went and did some axe throwing. I was not able to join them due to my son having COVID. So I couldn't join them, but they had a great time and FaceTimed me in so that I could see some of that action. And we're really sad to see them go. We continue to contract with Kat and Nicole on an as-needed basis, particularly for clients who need Spanish speaking or very specific kind of really in-depth marketing work. We still contract them out for those services. So they're still with us in spirit. And Macklin moved on to work with our Richmond office. So they had an open position that we were able to move him right into. So he is serving some of the small businesses of the Richmond area. And then next up, we brought Leo onto our team. Leo did not know that I was going to post that video. I'm sure he'll kill me later. But this is Leo, who has come on board with us for the New River Valley. He's our community navigator and advisor for that area. And as you all may know, that all of our advisors work in all of the areas. We really try to match people to the right advisor for them, no matter where they're at, especially now in today's environment where most 90% or more small businesses want to meet with us virtually. They don't want to come in person. And so it's allowed us to open up more expertise to them. But our community navigators are there to help connect and be their lead advisor and support them and get them resources that they need and really help the team understand what those needs are. And so Leo joined us for the New River Valley, and he's already making headway there, meeting with clients and with our stakeholders to really ground some roots, create some collaborative opportunities that we haven't had before. And he's well connected. So we're excited to bring those connections to our center and all of the work that we do in the New River Valley. And then here's Leo again. Like I said, he jumped right in. We have our C4 program out of Floyd that we run every year in the fall. And he just jumped right in and helped us with that program and went to a full day of pitches and met all of the small businesses and helped them. And here's a picture of just a few of them. And we'll note that the winners were all our clients, who are always excited about that, helping those businesses succeed. And then we often go to ribbon cuttings. We're asked to speak sometimes. And Heather was asked to speak with Blush and Ivy Boutique at their ribbon cutting out in Botetourt. And so we were happy and excited to do that. Here's a picture from our Vet Biz program networking event that we had. You can see where they're kind of sitting around and chatting, which is exactly what we wanted for them to meet each other. And then here is a picture of our Richmond and state office. Richmond is one of our mentees. They're a new center. They're 2 years old. And so this is a celebration where I went to help them celebrate 2 years. I work very closely with the director there and our state office. So this is a picture of us here at their celebration. I went to present on financing and then we partied a little bit that night. And so that's what we did there. And then you see Tom here trying to steal the elf cookies. This was at our Virginia Professional Development Conference that we have in the fall. And we had a great time this year. And we're really excited, not only that Tom tried to steal those cookies, that's Tom for you, but that Heather on our team was invited to be part of the committee that planned this professional development conference. And so we're excited about her contributions. And of course, all of our nudges about the things that we wanted to see, and she made happen. It was a great 3-day conference that we had a blast at. And then when we came back, we rolled right into Small Business Saturday, and our team, we are a champion with American Express to help distribute shop small goods to our local businesses, and our team dispersed throughout the region. We had Franklin County. Leo was everywhere around. The New River Valley is like the biggest footprint we have. And he was everywhere making sure these businesses had what they need, and Heather and Botetot. And here's just some pictures of the work that we did there. And it's just a time for us to connect with clients, but also make sure that they understand what it is and how they can promote it and the things that they need to do that. Okay, I've done a lot of talking here, but I'm also excited to share with you what we have upcoming. We've been working for about a year and a half on a project that we're going to be launching in January. And I've talked to you about it before, but we're even closer now. We're almost at the point where we can launch. And I just want to share with you this. Just our fun way. Oh, let me watch this again. I won't mess with it. That's just our fun way to communicate with people that, you know, before you come to Smart Start, if you're thinking about starting a business versus what it's like after, we really spend that workshop helping people understand what entrepreneurship is, but also the core tenets of what they need to start that business and get off and running. Once they complete that workshop, then they come on board with us and start to do one-on-one advising. We do require this workshop for everyone to go through before they go through advising with us, because it sets the stage for what they need to know. And so that when we start working with them hourly in our time, we're ready just to hit the ground running. And so we're super excited that we have done a refresh of this. We're getting ready to present our last class next week. And we've done a complete overhaul of not only the workshop, but what comes after the workshop and how we can support these startup businesses to really open effective businesses. We have a challenge in our region. People just want to open without doing research, and then they close within a year. And we really want to change that narrative and help them start really strong. And we know that just a workshop is not going to do that. And so we've been working on a software, building out our own software for people who are starting their business. It's called the Smart Start Academy. And if you're familiar with the Lean Canvas, we're using all of those principles here. But when people want to start a business, they're going to go through this process with us where they first do take a class. Our class is being revamped, and it's really an intro to entrepreneurship to get them excited about what they're getting ready to embark upon, but also share some of the realities of what entrepreneurship is. And when they finish that class, we're going to roll them right into our software where they can start researching and creating their business plan for their business. And it's going to be done in a way that they don't even really know they're doing a business plan. We know that business plans are boring. They can be overwhelming. We have people in our office crying over them. They're just a very stressful thing to do with people on our end and on theirs. And so we've made this a more fun process that prompts them to think about things, give them tools for research right inside the software. They can chat with us as they're going through this process. So as they need support and help, we're there to chat with them. And they get, so we've gamified it a little bit so that they earn badges and rewards as they go through the process. And then at the end of the process, once they've created their business plan, they can print that out and use it or come back in and change it. Business plans should be able to be changed over the course of years, and we want them to continue to use this with us. And so that platform will be launching in January and will be available for them. As a final part of that platform, and we hope to build this out in the future, there will be links and resources for them to actually launch the plan or plan the launch of their business. So like leading up to opening day, and we will have some tools in there, but that's an area that over the next couple of years, we'd really like to build that out even more. But we feel like we're off to a really great start with this software and can't wait for people to start using it and to share it with you. And the last part I want to talk about today is our finances. I like to always give you a quick update on where we are. And first, I want to show you all of the support that we've had in 2022, which has allowed us to do all of that work that you just saw. And in 2022 alone, we had $320,433.10 worth of grants working on projects. We had CARES Act funds coming in that helped us ramp up our team to support the efforts, as well as do a lot of the back-end projects that were needed to change the way we worked. Freedom First was a big contributor of our grants this year with their community grant program. We won two grants awards with them. Go Virginia was able to support some of our work through a Greater Virginia initiative. It wasn't directly through our office, but we did and were able to get some of those funds to make up for delinquencies that we had last year in funding. And then we received a grant from Roanoke City to support COVID-related work this year and to help us continue our operations. And so I always like to share the real numbers. This is what it took above and beyond our budget to do the work that I just shared with you and that we've been sharing throughout the year. For 2023, our overall budget, and this is with our grant and our expected cash match, is a little over $368,000. We're about $85,000 below capacity. And so we need $85,000 more just to have regular capacity, not to do what we just saw, but to have regular capacity. And so we want to work really hard with our jurisdictions to bring those funding dollars up to the 100% match that the Small Business Administration asked of for our grant, and also receive more corporate opportunities for those sponsorships. But this will allow us to fully staff our team and serve the demand that's coming in with the efficiencies that we've implemented. Without those efficiencies, we could never do it. But we feel like if we had the additional $85,000, we'd be able to meet the demands that we see coming and remaining in 2023. And then I want to take just a moment to really shout out to some of those main partners that do match our cash match. And this is not all encompassing, but these are our legacy partners. These are the jurisdictions that are supporting our work at 100% of the match for our Small Business Administration grant. This is only the first year that we've ever had this. We've never had a legacy partner before. And so we're really excited that we've been able to bring some of our jurisdictions up to that 100% match, and so thankful for these folks who have gone all in. And as you all know before, I've mentioned Botetourt County and Franklin County fund a full part-time person. So they're way above 100% of their required match, and really appreciate their partnership and the work that we get to do in those communities above and beyond what we're accountable to. And then our champion partners are those that do 75% or more of the match. You can see those here. They're all happen to be in the New River Valley, and just very excited about the support that they provide us and the work we're able to do there. And then lastly, I wanted to mention our corporate sponsors that we've received funding from this year. We do expect some additional funding before the end of the year to come in, but this is who we've received funding so far from. And just always excited. These are steady Eddies. They work with us throughout the year. United Way was added this year as a new partner of ours on very specific projects we were working on for them, which is how we build capacity, is through project work with organizations. And so they were one that came on board. And you can see those corporate sponsors there. And we'll look forward to updating that at the beginning of 2023. That's it for today. I want to open it up for questions. If you don't already follow us on social media, you know I'm going to beg you to follow us there. We are very active. You'll see people engaging with us. You know, one of the biggest complaints we get from people is we can't share with you who we're working with outside of these photos and things that we do. But guess what? You can see who we're working with by who comments and likes our posts. So that's like a sneaky way to get around our confidentiality. If they're posting, engaging with us, you can see it. But we'd love for you to engage with us there as our partners in the community so that people can see you. They're paying attention, and we would love to have you engage with us there on social media, even if it's just an emoji on one of our posts, or to let us know how you're feeling and how you're doing. We'd love to see you there. Let me take a big breath here and ask you what questions you have. What more can I share with you or follow up on? I know that I didn't do that good of a job. Or you could be overwhelmed. Any questions at all? I see some shaking of heads. No. Okay, well, you all know where to reach me. My email address, if you don't have it handy, I know some of you are standing in from others that may have gotten the invite email, is aforester@renwicksmallbusiness.org. Please feel free to reach out to me. I'd love to talk to you about funding or sponsorships, or if you want to take a closer look at our budget or some of the demographics that we have on clients, I am more than happy to hop on a call with you and share screen and walk through some of that information with you. More than happy to do it. If you've got ideas for projects that you want to work on next year for the community and small business, we'd love to be part of those. So please include us in those conversations. We'd love to be at the table. And we just really appreciate you. We can't do this work without you and your support and the work that you do for small businesses. So thank you very much for that. And I'll let you go. If you want to stay on and ask questions, you can. But again, thank you for being here. I'll make sure that this recording is available to you. And we'll see you next year.
Thank you.
Bye, everyone.
Thanks, Amanda.